Hello and welcome to today's video where I will explain to you why the planes are not getting faster and why we won't fly supersonic again. Please stay tuned for exclusive insights into the aviation industry that are about to come. You might think that with all the technological advances we have made over the years, planes should be able to fly much faster than they do. After all, even trains are getting faster with every decade. For example, high-speed trains in China can even reach 300 miles per hour. However, the new aircraft models that are being introduced are still flying at the same speed that they used to during the 1960s when the jet engines were introduced. You may even notice that the flights are getting longer. 50 years ago, it took 5 hours to fly from New York to Los Angeles, and just 45 minutes to hop from New York to Washington, D.C. Today, these same flights now take 6-plus hours and 75 minutes respectively, although the cities hasn't moved away and planes are not slower. The reason is the fact that airlines want to make flights more punctual and reduce delays by extending the scheduled flight time. It has to take into account multiple factors such as airport congestion, which is increasing. Now let's get back to the past. After the Second World War, although jet engines existed, almost all airplanes were powered by piston engines. However, as aviation progressed, the need for more efficient, powerful, and reliable engines grew. That's why turboprop engines were developed. At its core, it's an engine where the jet engine turns a propeller. Shortly after, in 1952, the first commercial jet aircraft, de Havilland Comet, was introduced. However, the first jet engines were very unreliable and they often simply broke down. At that time, technological development was progressing very rapidly thanks to the military competition of the superpowers, and aircraft engines were improving year by year. In 1962, the UK and France signed a treaty to share costs and risks in the supersonic commercial aircraft's production. That's how the aircraft known as Concorde was born. Concorde is the main character of today's video. It's the only, besides its failed Soviet copy, the Tupolev 144, supersonic commercial airliner that ever existed and transported passengers. The construction of prototypes started in 1965, and on 2 March 1969, Concorde made its first flight. The aircraft had the original design with a narrow fuselage, delta wings, and a droop nose for landing visibility. It was powered by 4 Rolls-Royce Nechma Olympus turbojets. Constructed out of aluminum, it was the first airliner to have analog fly-by-wire flight controls. The airliner could maintain a supercruise up to Mach 2, which equals 1,350 miles per hour at an altitude of 60,000 feet. However, after the initial hype, airlines began to cancel Concorde orders. The plane started to show its limitations. Only 14 Concordes entered the service. First of all, it was extremely expensive to fly, as in the late 90s the round-trip ticket was $12,000, and that is not even inflation-adjusted. After all, the airliner had just 100 seats and enormous fuel costs. When the Concorde was designed, jet fuel was cheap. However, with the oil crisis of the 1970s, the profit margins for the fuel-to-speed reliant aircraft quickly diminished. The aircraft consumed 4 times more fuel than the 747 when carrying 4 times fewer passengers. Moreover, Concorde was not allowed to fly over the land due to a sonic boom, a loud noise that people on the ground can hear when an aircraft breaks the sound barrier. So it was only possible to fly over the Atlantic. When the Concorde started its career, the first class consisted only of wider seats. So the only way the airlines could compete in the luxurious travel market was the onboard service or flight time. As time flew, the airlines started to update their premium class seating. In the 1990s, the flatbed seat appeared and it revolutionized travel comfort. People wanted to pay for a spacious seat that could be transformed into a bed, rather than for flying in the narrow and small Concorde cabin without the possibility of the introduction of such seating. In addition, flatbed seats in slower planes were much cheaper than flying supersonic. The airlines realized that they were not making money on Concorde, as large premium cabins were making the biggest profit from selling tickets, as I explained in the previous video. And slower jets were much better in these terms. On July 25, 2001, of Air France Concordes crashed. Due to this event, passengers began to fear flying Concorde, and in 2003 both British Airways and Air France retired the aging and inefficient aircraft without successor. Now the most important question is, why aren't the airplane manufacturers making new, more economical supersonic airliner? First thing is aerodynamics. The faster the plane fly, the more drag it produces. To some extent, supersonic aircraft can manage drag by flying at higher altitudes than subsonic aircraft, where the air density is lower. However, at supersonic speeds, wings generate lift in an entirely different manner than at subsonic speeds, and are invariably less efficient and thus require more engine thrust. So why airplanes can't fly slightly slower than supersonic? For all vehicles traveling through air, the force of drag is proportional to the coefficient of drag, to the square of the airspeed, and to the air density. As speeds approach the speed of sound, the phenomenon of wave drag appears. This is a powerful form of drag that begins at transonic speeds. Around Mach 1, the peak coefficient of drag is 4 times that of subsonic drag. Above the transonic range, the coefficient drops drastically again, although remains 20% higher by Mach 2.5 than at subsonic speeds. The problem of supersonic flying is also a noise that sonic boom generates. To fly faster, airliner would need more powerful engines that would at the same time remain economical. When Concorde was being designed, high bypass jet engines had not yet been deployed on subsonic aircraft. Had Concorde entered service against earlier designs like the Boeing 707, it would have been much more competitive. Turbofan engines improve efficiency by increasing the amount of cold low-pressure air they accelerate, using some of the energy normally used to accelerate hot air in the classic turbojet, which has a bypass ratio 0 to 1. The bypass ratio is a comparison between the mass flow rate of air drawn into the engine through the fan disc that goes around the engine core with the mass flow rate of the air that goes through the engine core. In an engine with a bypass ration of 10 to 1, for every 11 units of air drawn into the engine, 10 will bypass the engine core and 1 will go through it. Nowadays, the main problem of air travel is cost and not the time, as you can fly anywhere in the world in 24 hours. That's why airline travel is getting cheaper and cheaper at the cost of comfort, especially in the economy class. Nevertheless, Boom Technology, an American company founded in 2014, is aiming to create a supersonic airliner and recently announced its Overture aircraft, which looks much like a Concorde but is much smaller and can carry only 80 passengers at the most. Unfortunately, no engine manufacturer wants to take the supersonic challenge. Will it change? Time will tell us. In conclusion, planes don't fly faster because it is not worth it. Flying faster means facing more physical, economic, and environmental challenges, which outweigh the benefits of saving time. The future of air travel may thus not be faster, but smarter, safer, and greener. Thank you for watching this video. I hope you learned something new and interesting about the history and future of supersonic travel. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them below. And don't forget to like, share, and subscribe for more insights into the aviation industry. See you next time.